Now, of course, we got the interests. I put them as a circles. My interests are yellow, his interests are blue, and the success. We're talking a possible success. We're not talking a real success. We're talking possibility of success. And the success is green. Most of the deals are in this kind of color. My interests are different than his interests, but they overlap. In this way, we trade. Because my interest and his interest overlap. We got different view about the life, but they are interests overlap. And actually, all kinds of humans, if you order them, it's going to be a big, like a picture with a lot of all of these circles, where they interest overlap sometimes. And in this way, we can trade. Because our interests overlap. My interest is to get away with my grain, your interest is to get away with your cattle. Your interest is you to have a different diet except grain on the table, and my interest is, your interest is to get a different diet than your cattle, and my interest is to get a different diet than your grain. That's interest. And they overlap and we don't exchange. So the interests are like, sometimes this is no deal is possible. Simply because my interest and his interest don't overlap. See? So this is the thing. Interest of rebels, which wants to put out the government, and the government itself cannot be reconciled. See? Because one wants to put the government down, and the other wants to stay in place. So it's a fight. It's not a negotiation. It's a clear cut that there is no interest that can be negotiated. And that is very good to know that there is nothing possible. Our interests are completely separate. And the third one, which is very, very seldom happening, is a deal is possible with big success where my interests and your interests almost coincide. See the green part, how big is the success. We've got a big success and we can finish a very, very successful deal. That's still not guaranteed that we might finish. It's only the possibility. So now, a few selling point and time vegetarian, which I am. Now, no amount of discount, no terms of payment, no delivery, no whatever clause, no whatever price can make me buy a meat. You see, because I don't want it. I'm a vegetarian. Our interests are different. I'm interested in the vegetables, you're interested in selling for meat. So we cannot overlap. Whatever, even the best friends, there is no interest. A deal with moderate success, a typical sale of the house. Typical sale. You're selling your house, I want to buy a house. You want to get rid of your house, I want to acquire a house. And you've got different interests, because maybe you've got a different vision about the price and how beautiful is that house. You can have a different vision about the area of your house. See? But our interests overlap. This deal is possible with moderate success. It's not very exciting because we're going to have some kind of talking about and exchanging proposals until we reach agreement. But it's possible to reach agreement. It's possible. The deal is possible with big success. Now, me and my wife want to go to the cinema. Both of us want to go to the cinema. Let's go. It's a possible success. Since the interests coincide, we want entertainment, we've got different, it's the same interest. The deal can be very successful for both, provided we sort out the details. Talking at this stage about the interest on it. Are we talking about the proposal? How to propose? I'm not interested. Let's think about always the interest of the others and our interest, and to check up their position. Are they overlapping? Are they coincide or they're not reconcilable? Now, if we're happy about the cinema, we're all happy to go to the cinema. But if my wife insist on a comedy, but I insist on a fiction, now what a problem. Our concept, entertainment and cinema tonight, is the same. But the details cannot be reconciled, and the deal can collapse. And in this scenario, no successful deal is possible. There is no guarantee of successful deal, even of the interest overlap. It's only a possibility. It's only a possibility. What we need to do is, we may need to find out maybe we won't go neither on comedy, neither on fiction, but we go on a movie yet with both of us want. Say on a romance movie or whatever. So we need to find out what our interest will be catered for. Discovering the overlap of the interests, that's very important. And making the possibility of the successful deal a reality, not only possibility. Making this deal a reality is the task of the negotiators. Without this, nothing is going to happen. So first we need to discover the overlap, and then after, to making this possibility a reality of the successful deal reality is the task of the negotiator. It takes will. It takes will. It takes little strength or power to do that. And it's not only desirable, but actually it's a precondition of the successful proposal. If we cannot discover the interest of the others and position them according to our condition, you see where they are positioned and where we are positioned and how they overlap, you cannot have a successful proposal. Bearing in mind that sometimes the interests cannot be discovered quite well, but you have to try to discover the interests. Now, if we discover that this is the scenario, not it was possible. The rebels want to throw out the government, and the government wants to stay in power as much as it can. Now, discovering that deal, that no deal is possible, relieves us from the task of preparing a fruitless proposal. We have to prepare a proposal to the rebels when they want to kill me. Why the rebels have to make a proposal to the government when the government doesn't want to listen to them? And the government says, no, we're going to fight you and you're going to be criminals. Why have to make any proposal? Since no voluntary trading will be beneficial, we employ other methods to get what we want. Must understand, negotiation, it's a universal method of getting what we want by voluntary trading. Where there is no freedom, there is other ways. Without realization of mutual dependence, without both of us, we to realize our mutual dependence, if we depend on each other, the negotiation is turning to other forms of decision making, ordering, begging, asking, anything else, but no negotiation. Negotiation will have only voluntarily, really. The negotiation starts with this realization that both of us are dependent of each other. I need your goods, I need your cattle, you need my grain. Negotiation starts with that. And finishes when this realization is gone. When the negotiation finishes, when I get your cattle at my place, and when you get my grain at your place. Typical example is divorce. People get together, and they love each other, and they see their dependability on each other. They see they can't live with each other. But one good day, they said, no, why do we have to live with each other? Their dependability is gone. This is why divorce occurred. They don't feel that anymore. They can have a mutual dependence. See. So they get divorced. As any process, the negotiation has a start and an end. The end may come as an interruption. Not I receive my cattle, your cattle, and you receive my grain. One of the sides realizes the uselessness of his dependence on God. Or the mutual dependence may finish when the deal is closed. I got your cattle, you got my grain. But one of them may realize and says, aha, how much this wants for my grain? He's going to give me 1 cow for 2 tons. Ah, the other farmer offers me 1 cow for 1 ton. And I cut off negotiation because I see that my mutual dependence is not very well with this guy, and I cut off the negotiation. Because there is no mutual dependence. So realize that the negotiation can finish either by interruption, when one of the sides realize the uselessness of the thing. But please remember it, mutual dependence is the engine of the negotiation. Without mutual dependence, nothing will happen. As soon as one realizes there is no mutual dependence, he pulls out of the deal and the divorce comes. Okay. Negotiation is not the universal method of getting what we want. I've been told during the time when Bulgaria there was executions, the guys that have to be shot Not they offer everything to the finance club. They offer everything. They make everything from gold. They start threatening the Milan. Nothing else. Simply because there is no mutual dependence, you understand. There is absolutely no mutual dependence. And it's not universal method of getting what you want. You're gonna get shocked, whatever you offer to get guys. You're gonna get shocked in that set. You cannot negotiate with your hangman. You don't understand. It's not universal method. Don't try it all around. The guy puts a gun on your head, like a lot of, or start robbing your house. You can't negotiate. You cannot, because it's a violence. See, violence, not negotiation. It's not universal method. Excuse me. It's a universal method when we've got the conditions of getting to specify what are the conditions, mutual dependence. But when we don't have that, it's not universal method. It's universal method that is applicable all around where you got the condition. In a cradle, in an old age home, in a restaurant, in a supermarket, all around where you got the condition. This is why you say it's universal. But it's not universal in a way that not all situations can give a birth to negotiation. Not all situations. Okay, the alternatives of negotiation. Here's the alternatives. Okay. The first alternative is asking. Why have to bargain with your girlfriend? Where you can ask her, wash my shirt, or prepare me omelette with mushrooms tonight. You can ask her. In order asking to work out, it must be mutual and voluntary dependence. Voluntary dependence at this stage, and mutual. I depend on you, and you depend on me. It's similar to negotiation, but I don't offer you nothing on that. I offer only my smile and my good eyes. This is it. And you're doing it out of your good heart. I ask you, and you do it. This child is adopted with these two parents, and do you think that if he says, "Mommy, make me one mile," what she's going to say? No, I'm not going to do it. She's doing it for him, because she loves him. She never had a child all her life, and she wants to please that child, and she buys him nice clothes and all of this. And when he asks something, he's offering him. You see? So this is the first alternative, us asking. The second one is voting. In conditions we have for voting is when decision is valid only when quorum is available and when it's within the powers of voters. Therefore, you cannot vote about the free lunch. Even if all population of South Africa goes now tomorrow to election and says, let's vote now, everybody get free lunch. That's not in the powers of all of us. Depends on the economy and other external factors. So it has to be within the powers and the quorum have to be achieved. This is sometimes very much neglected. Sometimes places and people, amount of people, vote for things that they don't have power for. They really don't have power. But they vote on it, and decisions are taken, which is completely out of their power. They suffer because of that later, or some other people suffer. Three, ordering. There is the manager, and there is the computer lady, the secretary, and he gives us straight orders. Type me that letter, do me this account. Those are now conditions of ordering to be successful is the orders have to be taken only within the agreement. Now, if the guy says to his secretary, now please now go to my washing. She said, you're on the way, I'm not gonna do it. It's because it's not within the agreement of employment. You understand? You have to be within the agreement and only then. It can be successful. And you have to confirm the guy that is authorized to do it. Okay, pushing. That's similar now, bordering the violence. Now, the conditions for pushing to be successful is that the perpetrator feels, the guy that pushes, that he can carry his designs with impunity or is desperate. That's why I start pushing. This is why the policeman, when they arrest a criminal, they start cuffing him, and sometimes they give him a good greeting, you know? And they push him because they know nothing can happen to him. It's within their limits. So to do it. In one of the Bulgarian prisons, it was said like this. If you don't know, we'll teach you. If you can't, we'll help you. If you don't want, we'll push you. We'll force you. See? Pushing works, force works, only when the perpetrator realizes either it's going to go away in death, or he's desperate. So the amount of abuse is proportional of what we are willing to endure. I want to repeat it. The amount of abuse is proportional to our willingness to endure. See, so if you suffer abuse in any form, now say for example the customer always pays you late, and he knows that you're going to suffer it. See, the amount of debt abuse is going to be as long as you're willing to endure. He knows that you're willing to endure. This is why I push you. Push you down. And he pushes down because he knows that there is impunity. Okay. Now let the will turns. Now, I've got that case. I've got exactly that case. Customer paid me late. And at that stage, I didn't have so much. I wasn't powerful to cut him off. So I kept hearing him. After years, same customer come back. You know what was my first condition? Yes. Payment on time. They will do it. Now his payment is on time. There's no question. There's no anymore pushing. I'm not pushed. But he realized that I'm pushed, that he's going to do it with impunity. It's not going to be punished for anything. Therefore, he carries on. You don't need to do it. Okay. Discovering that the deal is possible, but our interests are not the same, makes us prepare a deal which will satisfy our interests and this. We need to find where our interests overlap and the position the proposal there. Reason. First one was, when the deal is not possible, we've got different methods. What other methods do you think we can have alternative methods of achieving decision? Except asking, ordering, pushing, what else? What do you think we can have? There is a blend, voting, we said. Can you think of it? Think about it and stop me after we find. We seldom have two people with the same value system. Absolutely. We don't have two people with the same value system. Brothers and sisters, husband and wife, they don't have two value systems. One values more things. You remember, we've got common needs and we've got personal needs. Remember in the beginning we said they're quite different. Even the common needs have different wants. Some people will be quite happy to eat bread, another people would like pizza. See? Some people would like roasted meat, I won't like roasted meat. So we've got different wants. And this creates also all of this, all the sum of sum and wants, the expression of our value system. What is our value inside of us? What's our interest? Remember, what we decide to do with our differences is crucial. We've got differences with our negotiating partner. The differences may enrich us greatly. It means your wish can be my gift and my gift can be your wish. Can enrich us, the civilizing factor, or they can separate us. The choice lays with both of us. The differences exist, and trying to reconcile the differences is a futile task. It's no good. You see, it's no good. Me knowing that my girlfriend likes to watch the soccer, and I don't like watching soccer, because for the 3 hours or 2 hours sitting and watching for something that people are, it's full waste of time. And I try to push her not to watch soccer, I don't do it. I don't know. Watch soccer. It's up to you. We've got differences. But let differences in taste, in things like, enrich our relationship so that we can get different things. While she watches soccer, now I've got free time that I need for my friends. And my friends also don't watch soccer. And to go out, this is what we did. You see, our differences can enrich us. But we can look at it as the differences that can separate us. And they said, you keep with your soccer, what I'm gonna do? And we separate it. You know, accept the people as they are, with their value system, don't try to change them. You see, when you see a big stone on the road, a big bull, the boulder on the boulder on the store, on the road, what do you do? Do you start hitting him? Schopenhauer says, when you see a boulder on the road, never try to hit him. There is an easy way, just pass around. You see, there is a boulder on the road, it's a character play. Don't try to change, push the person, it's a difficult task. And when you see somebody negotiate with difficult, with different value systems. Don't try to sell him it's wrong. You see, he may eat cent with sugar and he may pay a lot of money for that. Give him cent of sugar and you get enriched and he gets enriched. I can never understand how can the people, I'll again use the pavilion, can use dead clothes in the pavilion. For me, that's totally incomprehensible. But the people buy them. And you see, and if I want to get rich, I must open a shop there, buy dead clothes and sell them. See, that's how it is. I used to have a friend which in Bulgaria, there was a special market and he buys actually clothes from Turkey, from Istanbul, and he brings them to Bulgaria and sells them with sometimes 10 times the price that he buys the wisdom. And I ask him, how can you buy such a rubbish? He says, I don't wear none of them. This is what the customer wants. Our differences must enrich us. They exist to enrich us. When you see a difference, you must say, great. Great. We'll do something, some business with it. We got a different field. Okay? How much you pay for salt? How much you value salt? Not much, because we got it all around, right? How much it costs salt? 10 rand?
Yeah.
5 rand? Cheap. Huh? Very cheap.
175.
175? Very cheap. In the Empire of Thailand, 12th century, in the Timbuktu, the gateway to the Sahara Desert and the seat of the scholars, valued salt enough to buy it for its weight in gold. All what we have to do is travel through the Sahara Desert, go to Mali, give them all what we have in salt, and they'll give you what we have in gold. See, the value system is completely different than yours. You buy them from 175, and you buy tons, and you return rich, and you don't need to work. And your sons and your daughters and everything after you don't need to work. Simply because they change everything in salt, they change it in gold. And that was fact. That was a real fact. How can you not show that your salt cannot be his man's gold? See? They got so much of gold that they don't care. But they don't have salt. And the food without salt is terrible for them. And they cannot salt it with gold. By no means. See? Very seldom we have two people again with the same value system. Now I'll give a practical example. I needed an air gun. I actually am in love with weaponry and guns. From small one, I love it. My favorite is Beretta. I don't own a firearm, but I love them just about. And I need now an air gun. It's my air gun, it's my friend. We went on a camp meeting there, we put out the tents, it's lovely. It's nice when you start shooting with friends. We put a target and we start shooting. But there is a shop in Durban that they sell that. And they used to advertise in my newspaper. I said to them, guys, that's your advert in my newspaper. It's still there to look at the paper. It's still there. They needed extra advert in my other newspaper. I needed the advert. How much I value my advert? Very well. I've got them plenty. My paper is, you know, place for advert. How much they value their guns? Very well. They've got plenty of guns. They want to get rid of them. Okay? The value of their gun for them is low. Because they've got plenty. They don't want guns. They want money. Okay? They need an advert because the advert brings money. Alright? The value of that for them is high. Me, now let's look at my situation. Me, the value of the gun, hi, oh, I need that gun. Right? This is what I want. And the value of that, low, I've got plenty of space. Now, their high value, okay, the advert, can be exchanged for my high value. Okay, I want it. And their low value, the gun, can be exchanged for my low value. So my low value can be exchange of what they value high, the advert. So they feel they are a bargain. And this is how the trade started. See? They put a high value for a low value. Do you understand that? We're not talking about money, we're not talking about nothing. We're talking about perception of value. Perception of value. Nothing else. They value high my advert. And I value high their gun. I value low my advert. And I value high their gun. So I exchange my low value for their high value. And this is how the river runs actually. The river runs from the high to the low. Nothing can stop. And nothing can make it all the way. And this is actually the essence of negotiation. You're exchanging your high value to tier one, vice versa. You're exchanging your low value for what you value high. See? In this way, negotiation is